Morning to one and all present. Let us start with the session number 7. We'll continue with the instructions of 8051. We'll have the recap of the discussions that we had done in the previous class. In the previous class, we have discussed about the bit addressable memory, wherein we have seen as to what is the bit addressable memory, what is a section of the bit addressable memory, and how they can be used in many of the functions. We have also learnt about the logical instructions. To name a few, clear, that is CLR, set, SET, which is bit, then CPL, which is complement, and we have also learnt about the rotate instructions. The rotate instructions with carry as well as without carry. Rotate right as well as left. Then to understand these instructions in detail, we have taken a good number of examples for each of these. In the further session today, we will be talking about the control instructions, which is the last category of the instruction set of 8051. When you talk about the control instructions, let us take the analogy of a C program. In C program, we have many control instructions such as if statement, there is a while statement, do while statement, there is a switch statement also. Now, if you look at the if statement, it is a conditional statement. If you say, for example, if A equal to B, then we say a certain set of instructions are to be executed. Else another set of instructions to be executed. Similarly, the do while is also with a condition, but at times we use while in control instruction as unconditionally, while one, which means that when it is true, you simply enter and keep on executing the set of statements. Similarly, when we talk about the assembly program, we have two types of control instructions: the conditional as well as unconditional. When we say it is conditional, that means a certain set of instructions will be executed when the condition is being met, and if the condition is not being met, either we can have another set of instructions to be executed or you can simply terminate the program. So what is the condition that basically an 8051 checks for? If we recollect, the program status word register consists of control bits such as 0 bit, there is a carry bit, fine, and there is also a overflow bit and an auxiliary. But most of the instructions, condition instructions that are being supported, are either a bit being set or bit being cleared, carry flag being set or not, 0 flag being set or not. So these are the conditions which will be checked by the instruction under the category of conditional instructions. The unconditional instructions, as said, they are the instructions which execute unconditionally. Okay, so there also we have an unconditional statement such as small jump, absolute jump, as well as the long jump. To understand these control instructions, and in particular the jump, let us understand the range of the jump instructions. We have three range of jump instructions, that is relative, absolute and long. Now what is, why do we say it to be as the range of jump? Let us understand, when there is a jump instruction being executed, the control is being transferred to the specified label. And from there onwards, the execution of the new instruction begins. And it's necessary not that the control would be transferred back to the instruction from where the jump took place. Okay. So when we say there are three ranges of instructions, so the relative type of instruction considers the transfer of the control within the range of plus 128 to minus 128. This is the only range, and it is with respect to the program control value. So as you can see in this diagram over here, there is a next opcode which is, I mean, whose address is being held by the program counter, and then after that there is a jump to a particular label or a opcode. So this jump can either jump upward, I mean backward, right, or it can jump forward, which means that the opcode or the label that is being specified can be somewhere here or it can be somewhere here, fine, but the range in which the transfer of the control takes place is within 0 to 255, but when we look at forward and backward jump, it is just 127 decimal to minus 120 AD, and importantly we need to remember it is with respect to the current program control register value. So in correspondence to the jump, relative jump instructions, we have the type of instructions either to be as bit or it is byte. So it is either bit jump or it is the byte jump. So which are the instructions which come in the bit jump? So it is jump on carry, jump on no carry, jump if the bit is being set, if the bit is not being set, or we also have the jump when the bit is set, I mean when the bit is there and you first finally clear it off. Then we have the, these instructions are all the byte instructions. Okay, now what are these byte instructions? Which means that they check for the complete byte, right? They check for the complete byte over here. So these are all the instructions that are associated with the relative jump. The next we have is the absolute jump as well as the long jump. The absolute jump is within the 2K page. So what is done at the operating system for the memory management, the whole of the memory is being divided into pages and each page size is around 2K. Okay, so when it is an absolute jump, the label that is being specified with the jump instruction can be anywhere within the 2K page. It cannot go beyond the 2K page. And when we talk about the the long jump, it is the complete 64K of the memory. So that label can be anywhere within that 64K of the memory. So absolute jump is within the 2K page, while the long jump is within the 64K byte of the memory. Now let us look into the more details of this absolute jump as well as the long jump. How actually the address calculation takes place? Because we know that 8051 has the address line to be of 16 bit. It is a 16 bit. And for a 2K page, you just require 11 bits of the memory. So what is done is, in the calculation of the new address, the lower byte of the program counter along with the most, along with the lower bits of the most significant byte of the program counter is considered for the effective address, which would be totally of 11 bits, of which the higher lower 3 bits 0 to 2 of the most significant byte will be associated with the page number, right? So the page, now the page address will be fixed up, and within that particular page the remaining 8 bits, that is 2 to the power of 8, which would be 256, the addresses would be changed across. Okay, so that is what is said here. The absolute jump, bit 3 to 7 of the most significant byte of the program counter remain unchanged. So this is the program counter lower byte of the address as well as the higher byte of the address. So the lower byte of the address plus lower 3 bits of the higher byte of the address together correspond to 11 bits, which form the effective address. and this effective address would be within just 2k block of the memory itself, right? 2k block of the memory, and it won't be anywhere beyond that. The next one we have is the long jump, which I have already said is within the complete 64 kilobytes of the memory. So that complete 16 bit of the program counter would be used to calculate the effective address. The next we have is the unconditional jump. So the unconditional jump, based on again the range that we have already discussed of the jump, we have three jump unconditional jump instructions. S jump, which is short jump, again it will have the relative address itself, which would be within the range of minus 128 to plus 127. Okay, that means either it is a forward jump or it is a backward jump. Then we have the L jump, which would take totally all the 16 bit addresses. That means the label that we specify can be anywhere within the 64k of the memory. The next we have is the A jump, which is absolute jump. This is again within the 2k page or 2k block of the program memory. Now we have another instruction, unconditional A jump. So here the effective address is being calculated with the effective address is being calculated with the value that is associated with the DPTR as well as the accumulator contents. So DPTR is a 16 bit value plus the accumulator contents, which are 8 bit. So the sum total of it becomes the effective address, and that would be the label or where the transfer of the control would take place. So let us look at this example, or where do we use an unconditional jump, for example. So if you recollect the instruction which we have already discussed, move C comma P3.7. So it is a bit data transfer. The the port bit 3.7, that means the seventh bit of port 3, its value would be copied into the carry bit in the PSW, program status word register. And whatever is the content of the carry bit, whether it is 1 or 0, based on the data read from P3.7, would be put back into the latch, that is P1.6. And we say here S jump start. So start is the label, and S jump is an unconditional short jump. So this becomes an infinite loop. So every time what will happen, the data from P3.7 would be stored into the carry bit, and from the carry bit it would be stored into P1.7. So repeatedly or unconditionally, this is going to keep on executing. So these all enters into an infinite loop. Now let us look into the different conditional instructions. So the different conditional instructions that we have is JC, jump if carry. So this instruction would check for the seventh bit of the program status word register. So program status word register is a 8 bit register, in which the seventh bit is associated with the carry flag. So if at all there is an instruction which has modified the carry flag, and then you use this jump on carry, then the condition would be true. Then it would move on to, or the control would be transferred to, the specified label where the relative address would be calculated. The next we have is if no carry. That means it checks again for the carry bit in the PSW register. If at all the carry bit is cleared, then the condition would be true here, and the control would be transferred to the specified label whose effective address would be calculated into the program counter. So as I said, the analogy is to the if statement. Okay, so you can say if, right, C is equal to 0, then the condition is true. If C is not equal to 0, then the condition is true for the second one. So what happens to the program counter when any of these instructions get executed? So the program counter would be incremented by a value of 2. Then, depending upon the carry bit, the program counter would be having its effective address as relative, because already previous to the execution of this jump instruction, the program counter would already have been moved to the next instruction to be executed, and after that we have the jump. So if the condition is true, maybe in the first case or in the second case, then the program counter would be added with the current program counter value plus the relative address. So that becomes the effective address for the control to be transferred from the current program counter location or from the current jump instruction. The next one we have is again the bit jump, JB. So this basically checks for the bit in either the bit addressable memory, fine, or it could also be the registers which are bit addressable. So JB stands for if bit in the specified bit addressable memory is set, then transfer the control to the specified relative address. So like for example, the same the jump on carry instruction can also be written as JB, the address of the carry bit is D7. So in place of bit address, we can specify the address of that carry flag, which is D7, and then specify the label. Okay, so what is this jump if bit? It basically checks whether the bit in the specified bit addressable memory, so this bit addressable memory can either be the bit addressable memory by itself, or it can also be the registers which are bit addressable, whose address needs to be specified over here. If that content bit is equal to 1, then the control would be transferred to the specified location. This is just the opposite of the JB instruction. JNB, which says that if the bit in the bit addressable memory or the bit addressable registers content is 0, then you transfer the control to the relative address. We have another one which checks for the bit. So what it does, it basically checks if the bit is set, then before transferring the control, it clears off that particular bit. Okay, say for example, again I specify here D7. Okay, so which means that if at all the carry bit is set, the first condition is true, that is JB, then the control would be transferred to the specified relative address. And when it is transferring, what it does, it simply clears off the D7 bit, which is nothing but clearing the carry flag. So how does the program counter work? So now this is again a 3-byte instruction, so obviously it would be PC plus PC plus 3. Depending upon the value of the bit for all these three conditions here, if at all the bit is set for the first one, if the bit is cleared for the second one, and for the third one, if the bit is set, the condition becomes true. Then the program counter would be added with the relative address being specified against each of these instructions. Okay, and which becomes the effective address that has to be loaded into the program counter. Alright. So here we have the example to understand it in a much better way. So let us look at this example. Move A comma hash 10. What this instruction does? The value 10 would be copied into the accumulator, and the same value is also copied into the register R0. Then we say add A comma R0. So first time when this instruction is being executed, the addition of 10 plus 10 takes place. And then you check whether the carry bit is set. Obviously in the first loop the carry is not being set. So this condition is true because the carry flag is not being set. So what happens now? The control would be transferred back to the execution of this instruction. So this loop keeps on repeating till where the carry flag becomes 1. When will the carry flag become 1? When the contents of the accumulator becomes FF. because the maximum 8 bit value that can be loaded into any register is FF. So when there is a successive addition of the contents of accumulator with the contents of the register R0 takes place, finally the accumulator would reach at a value of FF. On further adding the value of 10 to that FF, obviously the carry flag would be set because it is exceeding the limit. So now that time this condition becomes false. So when this condition becomes false, it will exit this loop and it comes over here. So once it exits, what we are doing, we are again reloading the accumulator with a value of 10 here. Now you perform the addition of A, R0. Repeat again. Look at the instruction that we have used over here. We have said JNB D7. Now this is what? It is the bit address of the program status word 7th bit. Okay, that means instead of writing the carry, we are writing the address of the carry bit in the program status word register. This is how we can use the instruction JB, JNB and JBC, because the first operand is nothing but the bit address that has to be specified. So effectively, this is also doing the same operation that is being done by the JNC. But the way the instruction is being used is different over here. So what this instruction does is JNB, it checks whether the carry bit in the PSW is 0 or not. So when you say it is not bit, which means the condition is true, because the addition, again we are reloading with 10, 10 plus 10, it becomes 20, wherein the carry flag is still not equal to set to a value of 1. So now this again keeps on repeating. Okay, this keeps on repeating till what? The bit in the D7 address. What is the D7? It is the carry flag or the carry bit in the program status word register. Okay, the moment it becomes 1, when will it be 1? When the value in the accumulator becomes FF. Okay, it becomes equal to 1. That time this condition fails, JNB condition fails. So it will not loop back to add A, R0. Where it will come? It will come to the next instruction. So what is this instruction now? It does two operations. What are they? It checks whether the bit in the specified bit address is 1. It's true now in this example. Why? Because this loop exits only or the moment when the carry flag becomes 1. So that condition is true. So obviously the control would be transferred to this label loop, and when the control is being transferred, what it does? It simply clears off that D7 bit. So this instruction, what it basically does is, it checks for the carry flag by using its bit address D7, and now in this example the condition is true, the control would be transferred to the label loop and it will clear off. So once it comes here, again it starts executing the same all set of instructions. I hope you have understood the usage of the bit jump instructions, right? That is JC, JNC, JNB, JBC, and similarly it holds true for the JB. The next one we have is the byte instructions. These are the 5, that is JC, JNC, JB, JNB and JBC are all associated with the bit ones. The next we have is the byte control instructions. So the byte control instructions is JZ, jump if 0. So what is it basically checking for? Because we say it to be as a byte. So it checks for the contents of the accumulator. Let us remember that JZ and JNZ are the two control instructions which work based on the contents of the accumulator. Okay, and what is the flag that it checks for? It basically checks for the zero flag. So if at all the contents of the accumulator is zero, then the zero flag would be set, and then the condition JZ would be true. Okay, if at all it is used in the program. So JZ means jump if the zero bit in the PSW is set equal to 1, and the control would be transferred to the specified relative address. Now the operation of this instruction is, instruction operates only on the accumulator. A very important point that has to be noted, that it operates only on the accumulator. No other register is being used to check for this condition. It is always the accumulator. If the accumulator is 0, jump to the specified address. So if the contents of the accumulator is 0, then you jump. And what is the flag that gets affected? The flag that is being affected is the 0 flag. The next we have, on the contrary, jump if not 0, which means that if at all the 0 flag is being cleared, then this condition is true. So when will this 0 flag be cleared? When the contents of the accumulator is not 0. So that means there is some value, a non-zero value is there in the accumulator. Fine. And then when you say jump on not 0, the condition becomes true. Again, it checks for the 0 flag itself. So JZ and JNZ are contrary to each other. JZ will see if the accumulator contents are 0, then the condition becomes true. The 0 flag would be set. And then JNZ will again check for the contents of the accumulator. If it is a non-zero value, then the 0 flag would be cleared. And then this condition JNZ becomes true. The next instruction that we have is DJNZ. So this is a complex type of instruction. That is why 8051 comes under the category of complex instruction set computer. Okay, so if you see here, this instruction performs two operations. What are the two operations? It decrements the contents of the specified register, and it checks whether the contents are 0, and then the control would be transferred to the specified relative address. Okay, so what it does is, let us quickly open the notepad and understand it. Yeah. Okay, so let us say we have the contents of the register. Let me say, write it as move R3 comma hash 10, and as we have already studied the instruction DEC, I will say R3. Okay, and then this value, right, has to be moved into the accumulator, because if I have to use the JNZ, so we will say move A comma R3, and then I can say JNZ, jump if not 0, to the specified label as loop. Where will I write the loop here is, okay. So if you have to perform the operation of decrementing the contents of the register R3, check whether it is equal to 0. You do not have a direct instruction as JNZ to be used. Okay, we cannot write decrement R3 and directly write JNZ, because we have already discussed now that this JNZ instruction operates only on the accumulator. So it becomes necessary for us that the decremented value has to be put into the accumulator, and then we need to check whether the contents of the accumulator is 0 or not. So this what happens? This is going to repeat for 10 times. After it repeats for 10 times, the resistor contents would be equal to 0, and then it will simply exit from this. So the replacement of all this, right, can be simply done with what? I can write the same instruction, I mean same set of program as move R3 comma hash 10, and then you will, we will write here as DJ NZ R3 comma loop. Now where this loop will be, it will come to this instruction itself. Okay, look at the difference in the program now. So we have replaced these three instructions by simple one instructions. Nevertheless, internally it's going to perform the same job. But if you look from the programmer's point of view, it simply reduces the number of instructions to be done. So how this will execute? R3 is being loaded with a value of 10. It comes to this instruction, decrements the contents of this R3, so it becomes 9. It checks whether the content of this R3 is 0 or not. It is not 0. It comes back into the loop again. Again it decrements. Now R3 becomes 8. Is it equal to 0? No. It keeps on repeating till R3 becomes equal to 0. The moment R3 is 0, this condition fails. Okay, because R3 is now 0. The condition is true only when R3 is not equal to 0. So now R3 becomes 0, and hence it will exit the loop. Okay, so this is how we can use the DJ NZ instruction. So here now the first operand can be a resistor, or it can also be a direct address. Both are being permitted. I mean, the resistor type of addressing mode as well as the direct type of addressing mode is supported by the DJ NZ. And with respect to the bytes, DJ NZ will require 2 bytes, while DJ NZ direct would require 3 bytes. So operation decrement the contents of the resistor or the direct memory contents by a value 1, and it would be compared with compare if the result after decrement is 0. If it is not 0, then it jumps to the specified address, which is again the relative address. Hope DJNZ is clear. Yeah, the same this is one example where we can understand the use of DJNZ. The previous example that we looked, we looked into how DJNZ instruction is being implemented. But here we are seeing the usage of the DJNZ instruction. So what is done here is R3 is being loaded with a value of 4, and R4 is incremented. Okay, R4 is some value which keeps on incrementing depending upon the value that is there in R3. So this instruction decrements the R3, which becomes 3 now, and it checks, is it equal to 0? No. Then obviously it would go here. Again R4 would be incremented by 1. Comes back to this instruction. Now R3, which was 3, now it becomes 2. Is it equal to 0? No. Again it loops back to this instruction. Okay, so 4 times this is going to happen. After the 5th time, when R3 becomes equal to 0, it would simply exit this looping, and the next instruction followed by DJNZ would be executed. The next instruction we have is compare CJNE. So this is again a complex instruction which does 2 operations. What are the 2 operations it does? It's going to compare the contents of the operand 1 with the contents of operand 2, right? And then it's going to check whether they are equal or not, right? So once we need to understand that whenever there is a compare instruction, so what this compare instruction does, it's going to compare the contents of the operand 1 and the operand 2. So if you have specified R0 and R1 resistor, it's going to compare whether the contents of the resistor R1 is equal to the contents of the resistor R2. So whenever there's a comparison, 3 conditions happen. What are those 3 conditions? The first condition is either they can be equal. The second condition is it can be the first operand being greater than the second operand. And the third condition is the first operand is less than the second operand. But this instruction, that is CJNE instruction, checks only for the equity. So it compares the operand 1 with the operand 2. If it is not equal, so what is the possibility now if it is not equal? Either the first operand is greater than the second operand, or the first operand is less than the second operand. So there are two possibilities. Either the first operand is less than, or the second possibility is it is greater than, because they are not equal. So followed by this CJNE, what can be used is we can either use JC instruction or you can use the JNC instruction. Okay, so compares the value of operand 1 and the operand 2 and branch to the indicated relative address if they are not equal. Okay, it does that. If the two operands are equal, flow continues with the instruction following the CJNE. So the moment operand 1 is equals to operand 2, this condition fails because it's checking for a non-equity condition. So whatever is the instruction after CJNE would be executed. So the carry bit, as I said, the control byte, basically what it would do, NE in the sense, it's going to check for the equity, that is zero flag. And as I said, if it is not equal means it's going to check for the, if it is equal, it's the zero flag. If it is not equal, it is the carry flag. So this carry flag would be set. When will the carry flag being set? If at all the first operand is less than the second operand. Because CJNE is checking for the non-equity. So when you say it is non-equal, there are the two options left out of the three. Either it is less than or greater than. The moment the first operand is less than the second operand, the carry flag would be set. And otherwise, that means if the first operand is greater than the second operand, then it would be cleared. So what are the possibilities of having in the operand 1 and the operand 2? So the operand 1 can be an accumulator while the operand 2 will be an immediate address. Right? Similarly, it can be an operand or it can be a direct address. It can be at the rate ri and an immediate, rn and the immediate. So let us write the example for the CJNE. Okay, so it is CJNE. What is the first condition? The first condition says that the operand 1 can be A or the immediate. So it can be written as A comma hash 78H. Then comma some address lay assay as up. Okay, it's a relative address. So this is one of the possibility. So contents of accumulator is checked with the immediate value of 78H. The second possibility is CJNE direct address, that is I'll say 57H comma it's an immediate as hash 45H comma maybe down, and the label are all the user defined value, name. So this is the second one. It is it is A comma direct, not direct comma hash. It is A comma direct, which can be 57H. Okay, the second option. That means the contents of this direct address, memory address of 57 would be compared with the contents of the accumulator. If they are not equal, then it would the control will be transferred to down. The next one we have is at the rate ri comma immediate. So assume that there is some data into the RAM location which is pointed by the resistor R0. Okay, and at that memory location there is some value. It would be compared with what? The immediate, that is hash say as 65H, and then we'll say skip. Okay, so it is comparing and skip. One important thing that we need to remember is these labels, whatever we are specifying, should not be any mnemonic. Okay, like for example, I cannot use add over here. It would pop up with an error because it's an instruction. Instead, I can say as add 20, add R1. Fine, that's no, I mean it's not a keyword or a reserve word or an address, or it is a not a what you can say instruction. Then the last one we have is CJNE RN comma immediate. So it is CJNE RN. That means it can be any register between 0 to 5 comma hash 43H and then go to the specified label as up 1. Okay, so these are the examples which help us understand how operand 1 and operand 2 can be used along with the CJNE instruction. So let us understand these looping examples over here. So we have taken here a for statement. For I equal to 0, I less than 4, I plus plus. And there are certain set of instructions that get executed. So what is I over here? It has to be A. So if I have to replace this instruction, right, a C instruction with an assembly equivalent, then how it would be written? So I equal to 0. So let us take here as clear A equal to 0. You can also use any other register, nevertheless, because CJNE RN comma immediate value is being supported by the CJNE instruction. So we have cleared the accumulator contents and then it enters into the loop. You have got certain set of instructions. Then I plus plus is increment I. Now I is compared with a value of 4. Okay, so first time when it enters into the looping, A is not equal to 4, A is 0. So it comes back to this loop. It keeps on repeating. At a moment, A becomes equal to 4. So what happens to this instruction now? The value of A would be compared with the value of 4. So on comparison, A has already become equal to 4 and now not equal to, the condition fails because A is now 4 and it is checking with the value of 4 itself. So it does not go back to the loop. It will simply exit the loop and whatever is the instruction followed by CJNE would be taken up. Similarly, we have the another example over here. For I equal to 4, I greater than 0, I minus minus. So let us take here again I to be as A. Now what we are doing here is we are moving or we are loading the contents of resistor R0 with value of 4. Okay, and then there are some certain set of instructions over here. So DJ decrement the contents of this resistor R0. So is R0 equal to 0? No, R0 is not equal to 0. So here basically I is not A, it has to be R0 itself. Please rectify, this has to be the resistor R0. I is nothing but I is R0. I is not A, it is R0. Okay, I is R0 over here. So move R0 comma hash 4, so value being loaded, some instructions being executed, decrement the contents of the resistor R0. Is R0 equal to 0? No. Loop back, execute those instructions. This keeps on. The moment R0 becomes equal to 0, right, this condition is false. Why? Because this condition checks when R0 is not equal to 0, right? So R0 is now 0, it does not loop back to the specified label, it simply exits from the label. So we have got another couple of looping examples over here. Let us understand these ones. So here we have written move A comma 50H, B comma 00 and compare A with 50. If it is not equal, you come to this one. But what is here now? It is equal, right? Because A is 50 over here, and you are comparing it with also 50. So the control would not be transferred to this next, but instead B would be incremented by a value of 1, and then NOP and then jump. So previous CGNA we have seen where the condition becomes true and it jumps to the specified location. Now we are seeing that the condition is false because A is also 50 and you are comparing it with 50. So the zero flag would be set, and here the condition of not equal becomes false. So the instruction immediately after CJNE, which is move B comma hash 01, would be executed. Look at this second example. Move A comma AAH, B comma 10H. Then move R6 comma 50, complement the contents of accumulator. Okay, whatever is AA, it becomes 55 when you complement. DJNZ. So it decrements the content of this resistor R6 and loop back to this label, that is back 2. So this loop, that is complement A and DJNZ back 2, would be executed how many times? It would be executed for 50 times. So the moment this gets executed for 50 times, it comes to the next instruction. Okay, what is the next instruction that we have? Is DJNZ B comma back 1. So what is that B now? B is 10. Okay, it gets decremented by 1. So it becomes 9. Again, it comes back to the instruction wherein R6 would be loaded with a value of 50. So if you see, effectively this is a nested loop. Okay, so this is a nested loop wherein how many times this loop get executed? The inner loop will get executed for 50 times, then it exits, the outer loop gets decremented by 1, again the inner loop gets executed for 50 times. So in effect, both of these loops would be executing for 50 into 10H. So 50 is a decimal, 10H means 16. So 50 into 16, that equivalent decimal times, the loop would be executed, and hence based on the number of bytes each of these instruction takes, number of clock cycles each of these instruction take, we can find out what is the delay that is being involved, which you'll be seeing in your next modules over there. So this, we are basically looking at this example to understand the usage of DJNZ instruction to generate the delay function, or how nested DJNZ instructions can be used. We have another example over here. Move A comma hash 25, R0 comma 10, R2 is 5, and move at the rate R0. So now what does this mean now? 10? 10 is a memory location which is pointed by the resistor R0. So whatever are the contents, that is 25, would be copied into the memory location 10, which is pointed by the resistor R0. And then you increment this R0. So R0 becomes now 11. Decrement R2. What is R2? Which is 5. It becomes 4. Okay. And is it equal to 0? No. It comes back. Now what is there now? R0 is, which was previously 10, now it has become 11. So again 25 gets loaded. So what is basically the iterative loop does is, the consecutive memory locations, that is 10H, 11H, 12H, 13, 14 and 15 would all be loaded with a value of 25. So if you want to copy certain block of the data for a consecutive memory locations, then this looping can be used. So similarly, we have the another instruction, that I mean another looping example, as move A comma 00, then move R4 comma hash 12H, add A comma 05. So in the first loop, what will happen? A will be loaded with a value of 05. Decrement R4, 12H becomes 11H, and then go back again. So additive, that means every time there is a addition operation that takes place. What addition? 5 is being added to itself. How many times? It would be added 12 times. So it is as good as multiplying 5 into 12. So a multiplication equivalent can also be obtained through this particular function. Okay, so these are all the control, I mean these are the instructions associated with the control control based instructions. So quickly to wind up this particular session, so in the today's session we have discussed about the fundamental control type of instructions. We have seen that the control instructions are of two types, either they are conditional or they are unconditional, and the three range of jump is either relative, it is absolute, or it is long. In the conditional jump, there is a bit jump as well as the byte jump. So the bit jump can either check for the carry flag, or it can check for the bit of the bit addressable memory, or any SFRs which are bit addressable. When we talk about the byte jump, it basically checks for the contents of the register, or whether it is equal or not, that is CJNE, and it also checks for the contents to be 0, that is CJNE and DJNZ are the byte level. So these are all the conditional ones that we have discussed. And with respect to the unconditional, we have just briefed upon either it is an absolute jump, or it is a short jump, or it is a long jump. And through these control instructions, we have also seen how they can be used in the looping operations or the iterative type of the instruction. So we have taken a small C program using for statement and seen how you can write the assembly equivalent, and then we have taken couple of examples using assembly itself. Maybe it could perform multiplication through successive addition, or you can have a set of instructions wherein the delete can be used as the delay function, and so on. So in the next session, we would go into the discussion of the directives, which are most important for us to understand to write the assembly program. For any queries, you can get back to me on my email ID, which I have put it on to the first slide itself. Quickly, I will put on to. Okay, so this is my email ID, that is rupa.patwardhan@gmail.com, or the contact. So you can be free enough to write back your queries, and or you can contact me. Hope I would be able to help you out in clarifying your doubts. Thank you.